us in into organized crime, what it is, and, you know, let's proceed from there.
Okay, yes. Organized crime, there are two words, organized and the crime. Crime we know about, murder, we know about rape, and we know about, you know, social issues like that. When somebody wants to kill a person, you decide that your plan is going to be with a gun, with a knife, poison, and so on and so forth, and other high-tech employment. That is for an individual or just a little group. So when you now have a group that decides to carry out crime, so it becomes organized. It is like, you know, it's a syndicate. It is a cabal. It is, racketeers. Profiteers, and so on and so forth. And they are in virtually every sphere of life. You know, virtually every sphere of life, and then as the world becomes more globalized, even with the use of technology and so on, their activities get even more sophisticated. So you have organized crime, you have organized crime in, politics, have organized crime in virtually every sphere of life, as I have said. So the key issues that are classified as organized crime, you talk about, let's say, in the maritime sector, talk about the piracy. Piracy is organized crime. Generally speaking, it also happens in maritime. Human trafficking is organized crime. Animal trafficking is organized crime. Shipment of forestry arms is organized crime. Drug is organized crime. You know, and so on and so forth.
One of the pieces you wrote was on or you investigated was on the Togo Triangle. What led to that, and what's the experience there? It was an award-winning piece, right?
Yes. As the ordinary people, when things happen, we are not trained to see beyond the surface. Just like in politics, what has happened in a few days, for some days now, and the analysts said, the people who are somebody that you find dancing, the person is not just dancing, so it's somebody that is doing the drumming. So that is the way it is. So we have issues of oil theft in Nigeria, and it became very phenomenal that the oil theft in Nigeria was it equated as a parallel industry, a parallel oil industry.
Wow.
Bigger, larger than the oil industry of some other countries. So, and then we have cases of arrest, we have cases of raids, and they say that the Niger Delta boys at that time breaking pipelines and then those are just petty crooks, petty criminals. The real organized crime are done even sometimes with state support. You find countries like Spain, countries like Netherlands, countries like England, they issue license to pirates to go out to any other territory and then steal booty. Bring booties back. So that is how old activities like criminal activities like a piracy is. So now you also have states that are giving taxing support to certain individuals so that they will be able to carry organized crime. And organized crime is actually what you call a transnational crime. That is a crime that happens in more than one country, or it actors in more than one country. Yes. So coming to your question proper, so the Togo Triangle is something that is a phenomenon. Actually, people do not know about it. It is the Togo Triangle is a floating market. It's a floating market. It is a body of water triangulated by three countries: Nigeria, Benin Republic, and Togo. So it is now called the Togo Triangle. This is just an open sea market, an illegal market, where you have rogue ships that they come from, they come from Ukraine, they come from Russia, they come from South Africa, they come from God knows where else. So, and these people come, and that is where they cannot maybe feel okay coming to the Niger, to Nigeria. Some are so brazen, but they ask, okay, well, if you can steal crude from your country, bring it to the triangle. We buy. So that is actually what we're talking about oil theft in Nigeria, and I said there is a bigger story. So that bigger story that took me to the Togo Triangle, and then so I actually visited the Togo Triangle. Is more or less like a jungle. So it is who?
Okay. From what you say, you made mention of piracy as an organized crime, you know, and I'd like you to throw more lights on it, especially because government at this time expending huge money to deploy a mechanism, you know, for combating that within the Gulf of Guinea. So if we are going to get it right, you know, it appears we'll be dealing with hydra-headed, organized entities who may have even the forces of government in various countries backing them. So if we're going to get it right, what would you expect to see Nigerian government do?
This is a big question, and then there is hardly a simple answer. Piracy was the Somali, in Somalia, which became a failed state in 1991 with the fall of Siad Barre. And then so you have different faction warlords and so on, and then people decided, okay, well, let's go to the sea, and then hijack vessels and so on, and then people pay for it, more or less like kidnapping and so on. So it was more in that part of the world. Then of course, then put aside what we have in the Niger Delta area, there was 2004, 2005, it peaked, maybe up to 2009. I think everything went down when the government of President Jonathan decided to negotiate with the Niger Delta boys. So that's on one part. But then piracy has happened even in the Togo area and so on, where we may not have much. I don't think state institutions are really doing something big in trying to cope a piracy. The piracy thing, what has happened, like where the action is the Togo Triangle. What has happened is that if you don't hear about piracy more, and this is not because of what the government of Nigeria or what the government of Benin, Togo, and so forth are doing. It is not that. It is just the big boys in the oil theft business. They run the pirates out of town. They run that. It is just, it's a top war. So it is people with the bigger guns, people with the bigger weapons and so on, they are in control of that territory. And then, so you also look at the countries that are interested in the Togo Triangle. You look at Russia, you look at Ukraine, you look at China. A country. So you look at China, and so these are countries, particularly Ukraine and Russia, and South Africa, Ukraine, Russia, South Africa. These people are also people that we would have see mercenary as an industry. So if people, yeah, so the oil, dealers or the oil, those stealing the oil, buying stolen goods, so they have to also protect their own crop. So you have people coming in from Ukraine. It's not because look at far away Ukraine, they are coming. So it's a mercenary that also came in and then they see, oh, this is something lucrative. And then they are able to chase the boys away, and then they are in charge of the Togo Triangle. So still talking about the Togo Triangle, this Togo Triangle, which is a very good market, and then you have this rope ship, as I have said, and then there are two types of ship. You have the mother ship, the mother vessel, and then the daughter vessel. So it is daughter vessel that they bring in crude, stolen crude from Nigeria, and then they bring it to the Togo Triangle. And this is so transactions are made. What we are talking about, there is state support. State governments are remotely involved because they benefit from it. The government of Togo, they benefit from it. So once in a while, you will see people, maybe like Togo, the Navy, they will do a little chase. It's just cosmetics. It is just to say, oh, we are doing something. Countries are benefiting hugely from this activity. So security agents are compromised in all the countries that border, both in Nigeria, both in Benin, both in Togo. In any case, it is in Togo, it is not their oil in Benin. Oil, it's Nigerian oil. So they have nothing to lose. It is Nigeria that has the higher stake that will say, how do we stop? It is from the source. If the oil is not coming from Nigeria, there will be no Togo Triangle. That is the one. Then this illicit market also have tried because of there's the salt lake in Ghana, which is more, you can describe the salt lake in Ghana as Ghana as their own Niger Delta, you know, where they discovered oil some years back. But there was so much hype, maybe government was insincere, maybe they wanted to win election, maybe they wanted to say, that the oil could be oil. But the oil was not of the commercial quantity that they have advertised, and the people came in, and it's an oil producing nation. So, but later on, it dawned on them that the quantity that they had forecast was not, so now an opportunity also came, because when there was so much talk, in Europe and America, oh, we won't accept stolen crude from Nigeria. It also almost became something like a blood diamond in Sierra Leone, that, oh, we're not going to accept blood diamond from Sierra Leone. So we're also not going to blood oil from Nigeria. So but it's also just talking the good talk. And then but behind the scene, a whole lot is going on, because the destination of this oil are refineries in US, refineries in Europe, and other refineries in Russia. So there's no way you can say those countries are not there, stolen crude. So now, the operations there, the criminal activities became even more convenient when it was discovered that Ghana does not have the massive oil reserve that they have claimed. So smart people went to work here in Nigeria. So they take stolen crude, are taken from Nigeria, and then they take it, and then because some refineries are insistent that, look, we won't accept this, so we won't accept stolen crude. So to circumvent that, they now disguise this stolen crude and say it came from Ghana's salt lake. Right. So it is dressed up as a legitimate product from Ghana salt lake, and it is now sold to refinery. But if people really want to go deeper, you can tell whether crude oil is from this particular a sample of crude oil is from Ghana, or it's from Nigeria, from Angola, or it's from Sao Tome and Principe, or it's from Equatorial Guinea. So the, what you yes, you can fingerprint the oil, and you can tell because of the geological properties to say this is where this oil is coming from. So all these things are really well activities in the Togo Triangle, for instance.
So what you're saying now, are you saying that our efforts, the efforts of our government, would not do much until it begins to address the persons who actually steal our own oil and export illegally to this country or smuggle out?
There is so much talk about, you know, government efforts and so on. Who are the people that are supposed to PDS, you know, police the environment? Is the security agencies of any particular country? And then in this case, the navy is there. NIMASA is there. There are several other security organizations that are
we're also partnering with Israelis to do it, and Israeli agency to do it. And so don't you see the light in the tunnel with all this effort? We have aircrafts being mobilized, we have vessels, we have people being mobilized. We now can see, you know, the waters. We now can see the Gulf of Guinea, you know, unlike before. Wouldn't this effort in any way, you know, affect or tame, you know, the piracy incident in the Gulf of Guinea?
Yes, it could, if the political will is there, which I don't know. From ordinary people, for the public, the only way to say that this effort is the effort are using its result is when, you know, Togo Triangle dries up. That is the only way of measuring and saying, okay, these people we are getting it right. But again, is it not the same in Nigeria where a Russian vessel was seized for, oil theft, and then it took how many months, and it was detained, and then we woke up one morning, and then we were told that the vessel was not carrying oil, but it was now water. People took out the oil and then pumped in this thing. So are you telling me that people from Russia, they sailed all the way from Russia just to come and take Nigeria's seawater, and so on. That was that. Then that ship also disappeared, and. So these are some of the issues that have happened in the past, and then it begins to question a lot of things. But like I have said, it is only when we don't have the Togo Triangle anymore, the oils are not coming from Nigeria, that is only when we say, okay, yes, the policing of the Nigerian territorial waters have been effective. Then apart from piracy, and then oil theft, the other thing, there's a particular vessel that was even arrested in Nigeria here for illegal fishing, and this vessel escaped from Nigeria. It escaped in port, and then this vessel was now arrested for doing the same thing in Liberia. So if Liberia, it took what Nigeria could not do, it took a smaller country like Liberia to be able to arrest this vessel. So I'm not saying that Liberia has a superior navy, superior to Nigeria, or they have other security, superior, security apparatus than Nigeria. So these are the big questions that we need to ask.
One of your stories, one of your winning stories, also centered on the importation of arms, the illegal importation of arms, that means the smuggling of arms into the country, So has that trend, in quotes, been checked?
Okay, that is also, when we don't hear there are many underreported cases, many underreported stories, because the people who, when things happen and arrests are not made, that does not mean that there's no more, there's rising index of drugs, there's rising index of arms, you know, arms are smuggling, and so on. And this comes about because of, again, state support. Neighboring states, including Cameroon, but particularly Benin Republic and Togo, they are undermining in no small way the sovereignty of our great country, Nigeria. Now, when you look at Benin port, for instance, Benin port tried on transshipment. Ordinarily, Benin has no business transshipping cargoes, you know, to a country that has, you know, almost as, you know, HC ports, the ones that are working, the ones that are operating, or the ones that are not operating. So that is so that is one. So because of this transshipment, what now happened is that the attraction of importers again, too, because of the ease of doing business in Nigeria. But the other end is this. Togo and Benin Republic, what they do to boost their own economy is they look at the Nigeria's import prohibition list, and then that is what they now allow to come into their own country. So I can't imagine, say, America and say Canada, or America and Mexico, and then the U.S. will say we have banned this, and then Mexico now say, oh, please bring it on, bring it to our country. And because the final decision is going to be U.S., there's no way that the U.S. government will take that from Mexico. So now, smuggling has state support. Smuggling is a good sector. It's a good revenue earner for the government of Benin Republic and that of Togo. So when they bring in this, so all this smuggling of rice, smuggling of second-hand clothing, smuggling of all those things on import provision list. So, because it is not something that they will sell in their own market, it is so done in a way that you cannot sell any transshipped goods in Benin Republic. You also cannot sell it in Togo. So it's also none of their business. So when this has not happened, that criminal element, organized crime group, now infiltrated, and they say, okay, because now Togo port is porous, they allow that. Benin Republic, the colonial port is porous, they allow this and they allow that. So drug dealers now cashed in. Arms dealers now cashed in. So if you look at the arms, the small arms coming in and so on, people say from Libya, from this, from, look, the arms that are coming in, they come in through Togo and the Cotonou port, and then on they go through land borders, then to journey to Nigeria Republic, and then it enter Nigeria, it enter Cameroon, as the case may be. So activities of drug dealers, activities of gun runners, I cannot say that it has diminished. It has not.